Praise the Lord. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Good Friday service at Niagara Falls Christian Ministries. Let's all arise for the beginning of the service and we'll pray. Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your love that you showed on the cross. We thank you for your amazing love that nobody could show, but you did. We thank you that you died on the cross and you took our sins upon you, Father God, and you gave us new life. You gave us victory. You gave us new beginning. And as we come together, Father God, we ask that you give us your Holy Spirit. So when we will worship you, we will remember the crucifixion, your suffering, your pain, that you bore on the cross for our sins. Wash us with your blood this morning and fill us with your Holy Spirit. Lead us and guide us and speak to each and every individual this morning so we will remember that how much you loved us and you showed your amazing love on the cross. We thank you and we worship you and we glorify your name. In your mighty name we pray. Amen.
Good afternoon, everybody. Today I will be bringing in front of you one of the first words that Jesus Christ said on the cross. I will say what's in our Holy Bible, and then as the congregation, you can repeat the response. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." Response: God provides in Jesus forgiveness, the restoration of relationship, and acceptance of forgiveness. So today is Good Friday, the day of mourning and grief. On this day, we remember how our Lord, King of Kings, our Good Shepherd, our Father, and our Savior, Jesus Christ, died on the cross. Let me ask you this question. Why do Christians across the globe remember this day the most? Is it because of the crucifixion? Is it because of the humility that he faced alone? Is it because of the 40 lashes? Or is it because of the pain that he suffered from the 7 to 9 inches long nail that was used to hang him? All of these things we know, that how this day was unfolding on Jesus Christ. But we Christians, along with the rest of the world, tends to forget one thing. And that one thing is love. Love is a four-letter word that was cursing through Jesus' body on that day, on that time. He loved us so much that even on his last dying breath, he asked his Father to forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Can you believe in the power on this 11-worded sentence? The power of forgiveness. Even though he was humiliated, took 40 lashes, pain from the nails, and the blood coming out from wearing a thorny crown, he still asked his Father to forgive us because of love. With love, he ended everything. Even if you remember all the all-time famous verses in the living and breathing God's Word, the Bible. Love your neighbor as I love you. For God so loved the world that he gave up his only begotten Son. In today's time, we forget the great sacrifice that our Lord Jesus Christ did. Every year we come before and we say and we remember this day. But if you look at it, after a day later, 2 days later, a week later, we do the same exact things. We forget the great sacrifice. We should always remember where our roots lies, where we came from, who is our Father, who is our Shepherd. We should always remember what he did on this day for all our lives. Love one another and forgive each other. Because the time is coming to an end. When we face Jesus, our hearts should be filled with love, but not with hatred. Thank you.
Thank you. Jesus' second word from the cross is, I tell you the truth. Today you will be with me in paradise. Response? Jesus is the essence of common miracle producing grains of hope. Paradise found, presence with God, often as I acknowledge my sin and then recognize God's Son. So as we read the crucifixion from the Bible, that it tells us that Jesus was not the only one who crucified on that day. There were two thieves, one is on the left side and the other was on the right side. So as Simon read about first word, that it was about forgiveness. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. So, when Jesus said this word, the two thieves, they heard that. They heard that word, and both of them took this word differently. On the left side, how he took this word? He said, he was demanding to Jesus that, please, save us, and yourself. Please save yourself and save us. So he took that word that for himself and for the Jesus Christ. If you are king, then save yourself and save us. So his voice and other words blends with the crowd, because the crowd were shouting at him that you, if you are king, then you have to save himself and save us and save. So the voice of the left side thief, it was blended with the crowd, because they just saying, save us, save us. So both of so when the other thief on the right side, he heard that word, forgiveness word, he was very surprised that the people are hurting Jesus Christ, and they are making fun of him. Why he's asking from God to forgiveness? Why he's asking forgiveness? So the thief on the right side, he was looking the word. His first word in a differently. He was looking the forgiveness. How a man can forgive in those people who are hitting them, who are making fun of them, and those people who are not, who are just, if asking water, they are giving vinegar to him. How he can ask forgiveness for them? So the other thief, he just realized and he took the word very seriously and in a different way. So first he sees Jesus is innocent, are being killed, crimes that we committed, but Jesus is being punished in his innocence. Second thing, he realized Jesus' death is not the end, but it is the beginning. This is why he asked Jesus to remember him when he comes into his kingdom. He knows Jesus' death is not the end of his reign. And because of his faith, Jesus replied that, I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in the paradise. So, as we read, So, are you sure that you are be with Jesus in the heaven? Yes, because we accept Jesus Christ's crucifixion. We accept his word. The criminal, he did so many bad things, so many bad indeed. But in the last, when he encountered the Jesus, he accept his word. His first word of forgiveness, because he knows this is very hard thing to forgive other people. So he took that word and he just grabbed the God and God mercy on him and God humbleness come on him and he accept the Christ. He accept his humbleness. He accept his crucifixion. And not only he accept that thing, he didn't demand to save him. He said he asked for eternal life. He don't want to save for the world. He want to save himself for the eternal life. So he asked, he knows what he can give me. Because what Jesus said that God, Father, forgive them because they do not know what they are doing. So he was addressing God as a father. When he heard that word, that why he is addressing God as a father, so what he said, what he accept, this is our in our life. How we accept the word of God, how we take it in our life, the word of God. Thank you so much.
Let's all rise.
You may be seated.
When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother."
Those who are lost are in. Those who are lost are found. Those who are alone are brought into community. You and I have accepted whom to love standing.
To be born.
as it is written in Matthew chapter 27, verse 46. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?
And for all, Jesus took the punishment and rejection that deserves it, that I might experience God with my Father as I was created to, that I might be restored into a relationship with God.
Yeah.
that everything was now finished and took the full scriptures, he said, I am thirsty. This is the Gospel of John, chapter 9, verse 28. The response.
All is fulfilled in Jesus, the past, present, and future. He is the Alpha and Omega. Jesus accepts the bitter drink of the fulfillment of prophecy.
Yeah. to reconnect us from him. It's great
move our Savior to for us. He wanted to give himself for us. This is true love of God, who came to save us from the bondage of the sin, and he saved us. The suffering and agonies in redeeming man are over. The work long contemplated, long promised, long expected by the prophets and saints is done. The toils in the ministry, the persecutions and mockeries, and the pangs of the garden and the cross are ended, and the man is redeemed. What a wonderful declaration was this. How full was consolation to men, and how should this dying declaration of the Savior reaches every heart and affect every soul. All our sins are taken away, Jesus announces here. All our guilt that should have been imputed to us but was imputed to him was taken care of. And Jesus announced it here. Our salvation is won. Our sins are forgiven. How do I know that? How do I know that with certainty? Ultimately, he was crucified for men's sake. He gave his holy flesh as a sin offering, and he redeemed man from sin. Because the Lord Jesus Christ announced so that all could hear, and the beloved disciple could record it. It is finished. Jesus did it all. It all accomplished. It all been done for you. The Lord Jesus Christ is complete Savior. He is a Savior. We hear that from this word, it is finished. And we can shout with all the saints down through the ages, Hallelujah, it is finished. Thank you.
Let's all rise together. Let's sing. Thank you.
Yeah. Let us not just harden our hearts, but let us soften our hearts so that your word will penetrate through each and every bone and sinews in our body and just become one with us, so that we will experience not just your goodness in our life, but also in the times when the times are hard, we will know that you are God, you are my Lord, you are our Lord. You are our Savior, and all these words will make more sense to us. Father God, help me to preach this message, because without your help, Holy Spirit, I'm not able to say a word. As I utter these words, soften the hearts so that we all can hear what you are going to say. In your name I pray, amen. As you have heard, you may be seated. As you have heard from different people today, that Good Friday is about the Friday for Jesus, right? It is good because Jesus was crucified. There was nothing good about the crucifixion, but what happened after the crucifixion on the third day, that became the good part of it. And something good did happen on the cross, right? Jesus took our sins. Jesus took our, I don't want to go to a Sunday school list of things that Jesus did on the cross. Most of you have been hearing what he did on the cross and why he died on the cross. And those of you who don't know, he died because he didn't want us to die. That's why he died on the cross. So we just sang a song, Worthy is the Lamb, right? He is worthy. We call him worthy because he did something for us. He made us worthy. We were not worthy before, but he made us worthy. So today, when we are listening about Good Friday, hearing messages about Good Friday, just one day in a year, we hear about all the things that Jesus did on the cross. I just want to ask you a question. I want to present you with a question, because this question has been in my mind for a while, and especially when I was preparing this message. And the question is, what is Jesus worth to you? What we worth to him, he showed it on the cross. He demonstrated it beautifully on the cross, that this is what your worth is. But as people sitting in this church in 2022, I just want you to think about this question for a few minutes. What is Jesus worth to you? So Jesus is some people worth more than everything. And for some people, Jesus is worth nothing. He is just a figure. Let's look at some of the things that happened between Palm Sunday and Good Friday, and then we will talk about the worth of Jesus Christ. So last week, many of you were here, and we saw that people who think in a worldly way, what Jesus worth to them. For the donkey's owner, he was worth a new donkey. He freely gave the new donkey and said, yeah, Lord needs it, take it. Donkeys were special during those days. And it's still in some part of the world, donkey is the main source of income, provided it's a domesticated animal, and it's been used in a lot of home things that people do, especially those who are living in the villages. So for the donkey's owner, Jesus was worth a new donkey. For people who were looking for a military king, a king who's gonna come and rescue them, save them. As I think it was Sadia, she was talking about how people were, the thief was actually mixing his voices with the people and saying, save me, right? So for people who wanted the safety or who wanted to be saved, for them, Jesus's worth was their outer garments, their clothes. And we talked about how important those cloaks and coats were during those days. People did not have a ton of coats or cloaks to put on every season or every day, or go with their dress suit or the semi-casual or casual. They might have one coat to keep them warm during the nights. But for them, because Jesus was in their eyes military king, his worth was one cloak. So they put the cloak down. And for those who didn't have cloak, they cut the branches of the tree. Palm trees, that's why we have a palm branches in the church. So for many people, Jesus had different worth before the crucifixion. 5 days down the road, the same people who gave up their cloaks, the same person who gave up their donkey, the same disciples who were sitting and getting him washed his feet yesterday, last night, they all turned against him. And today their voices are mixing with the voices of Pharisees and Sadducees and all these religious leaders who are asking, crucify him, crucify him. So what happened? Why there was a sudden change in the attitude from giving Jesus some sort of a worthy title or some sort of a word? All of a sudden he became nothing. They wanted to be released. They wanted to release Barabbas, a criminal, a thief, a murderer, instead of Jesus. What happened? Because all these people, they did not know the true worth of Jesus Christ at that time. That's what changed their minds so quickly. It was just like so many of us today sitting in the churches around the world. We don't know the true worth of Jesus Christ. Many of us can say things about Jesus. Many of us can say, if Jesus was here today, I would not be the part of that group. Let me tell you, would be with us today, and he will be with us one day, but if Jesus was here today, we would do the same thing all his disciples did. Betray him, leave him, run away, curse him. We would do the same things. Because and before the crucifixion and resurrection, we did not know what is the worth of Jesus Christ. And I think that those people would have a little leeway. Like, you know, crucifixion hadn't happened yet, right? Resurrection was 2 days apart from now on. So they still have some leverage because they did not know that Jesus was crucified for their sins. They can get away. But us, who know the whole story, who know why he came into the world, why he was crucified, why and when he was resurrected, we know the whole gospel. And if we don't value him worth than anything, we are in a big trouble. If we are attending church from when we were babies till now and we still don't value Jesus, mark my words, we are in a big trouble. For the religious leaders, Jesus was worth of 30 shekels only, 30 pieces of silver. They didn't know his value. Judas, he got the money and he said, if I will kiss that person. Judas walked with Jesus, 3 years spent with Jesus, but Jesus never meant anything to him. You know, there is a very interesting fact that I just figured out by listening to some radio preacher. Judas never called Jesus Lord. Every time he addressed Jesus twice or three times in the Bible, and every time he called him either a rabbi or a teacher. A rabbi is a teacher anyways. So he called him rabbi and a teacher. Why? Because for many of us, Jesus is just a good teacher who tells us good things about us, who has good teachings. Love your neighbor as you love yourself, right? Beautiful sounding, you know, this utopian society sounding statements he's making. Love your neighbor. Give to those who don't have, right? If you have two cloaks, give one to someone who is in need. He's talking a lot about socialist stuff to do. So for some people, Jesus is a really good teacher. And that's who he was for Judas. That's why he put the cost on him is, okay, Jesus' price was only 30 pieces of silver. You know, 30 pieces of silver is a very unique measure of money, and it is being used in Bible earlier in the Old Testament. So 30 pieces of silver you will find in 30 shekels in the law of Moses. So in the law of Moses in Exodus chapter 21 and 32, a slave was supposed to be free. If you want to free a slave, you pay the price is 30 shekels. 30 shekels for a slave price. So for Judas's eyes and then in the religious leader's eyes, Jesus' price was just like a slave. Anybody can give 30 shekels. And also, remember the story of Joseph? When Joseph was sold into slavery, he was sold into for 20 shekels, which is almost equivalent to 30 shekels of Jesus' time. So it is a price of a slave. And then in ancient culture, Jesus' culture is very different than our culture this day, especially in North America. But in Middle Eastern, ancient Mesopotamian culture, 30 shekels was considered an incomplete transaction. It was like not a lot of money. It was not like a base money. The base money was 60 shekels. So if somebody has 30 shekels, it would be like, it's nothing. For example, penny means nothing to us. It literally means nothing to us in Canada. But penny, wherever it's been used, one penny is nothing. Half a penny is nothing. So for that culture, 30 shekels was nothing. And these religious leaders and the Judas, they knew about the value of money. Remember, they were doing buying and selling in the temple. They had a big business in the temple. So they knew the value of money, but they did not consider Jesus as valuable. So Jesus' worth was either less than a slave or less than worth anything for them. And I'm going to repeat it. They can get away with it because till that time, Jesus was not crucified for their sins. Jesus was, he did not take the cross. He did not get the beatings. He did not die. They can get away with it. But for us, we have no excuse. Because crucifixion happened and then resurrection happened. So, if we consider Jesus worth nothing or something, okay, let's talk about something. I consider Jesus the most valuable person in my life, right? I say it, but in many areas of our lives, I don't even think about him when I'm making a decision. I don't even think whether Jesus is gonna agree with it or not. I'm not gonna point fingers at anyone. I'm gonna point fingers at me. It is just so mind-boggling when you read the Word of God and you look at it and then you look at yourself and you're like, what I am doing? How much this person who walked the road of suffering for me, week after week, we talk about it, yet he does not mean everything to me. Yet it is so difficult to follow his first command. Love your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with everything that you have. It is the most difficult commandment to keep. So what does Jesus worth to me? I've been a Christian for over 24 years. And when I started good, like many of us here. Full of passion, I'm gonna give up everything. Kill me, I don't care, I love Jesus. And now, 24 years down the road, a lot of us go through that time. A lot of us have a good start, but when the time comes to give Jesus the priority in our life, when we understand, when we started understanding the Bible, the Word of God, what Jesus did, and then slowly these all becomes words, fancy words in the Bible, fancy teachings that I give, fancy sermons that I hear, fancy concepts and ideas, because we live in the world and we think that we can live in the world and yet live for Jesus. Jesus is sort of like a sidekick for us, not the main person. We have seen the video. Thank you, Simon, by the way. It was a beautiful presentation. We have seen that Jesus was totally murdered for our sins. Did you notice something when they were lashing him? But before they started lashing him, his whip was just stuck on the table. And the table got, damaged. And I think it was, they were presenting, it was either Caiaphas or I think it was Pontius Pilate. No? Yeah, right? It was Pontius who was sitting on the table. And he gets upset at the person who had the whip in his hand, that you damaged my table. Two things there. Either that person loved his table, or the person was angry at him that this is the kind of flesh we're going to use on Jesus' back. I saw a lot of people were shedding tears when the video was playing up there. But so quickly we forget what we just see. It is so, our memory, in Finding Nemo, she said, I have a short-term memory loss. We all have that. We have a temporary amnesia. As soon as we see it, in the moment, Jesus, I'm going to give my life for you. And as soon as the time passes by, Right after we leave this church, right after this sermon, we meet at the back and we will forget about it. That's how short-term our faith lasts, because we do not worth Jesus more than 30 shekels. I have pieces of paper on the floor down there, and I will just see how many people will follow what I'm going to say. Take that piece of paper. It has a question: how much Jesus worth to me? And think about something and write it down. Not any theological question, but the truth. And I'm not going to read it. You guys will do it. Think about it. How much Jesus worth to me? But complete honesty. Like, I'm very honest here this morning. Since past few months, Jesus's worth is not what it used to be in my life. Why? Because we are so burdened by all the things that is poured on us. And in past few years, pandemic and everything else, we are so weighed down by the burdens, all of us. So today, I just want to give you one task. We will continue this message on Easter Sunday, but I don't want to take too much time right now, because I just want us to have this question sink in. What is Jesus worth to me? Is he just a good teacher who sounds really good for many, many denominations? He is just a good teacher for millions of people around the world. Jesus is one of the good teachers. He is almost as good as Buddha and Muhammad for a lot of people in the world. And these are the people who go to church, who attend church every single Sunday. There are millions of Christians for Jesus. Is a transaction, a bank teller. He's a machine. You give him $20 and he's going to give you $40 back. For men, and people have built their empires on, selling Jesus. These are the pastors, and I'm not talking about people who are not in the family of God. I'm talking about people who go to church Sunday after Sunday, who teach the Bible, who listen to the Bible, and when you're talking to them, they have good things to say about Christianity, but they don't worth Jesus more than a genie in a lamp. If you rub him right way, he's gonna give you wealth or health. For so many people, Jesus is like that. For so many people, Jesus is just a God who is just sitting somewhere up there, have nothing to do with our lives. Even though in the Bible it says that he became human, for whose sake? For our sake. He bore our shame. He took our iniquities upon himself. He died as an innocent lamb. Not because he deserved to die, because we deserve to die, and he took it upon himself. So what is Jesus worth to us? After knowing all these truths about Good Friday, about crucifixion, about the life, and about the death, and about the resurrection of Jesus Christ, whatever, how many years you have been walking with Jesus, what is Jesus worth to you personally today? Take that paper, write down on it, and put it somewhere visible in your home or office where you can see it. It will remind you that this is Jesus was worth to me on this Friday, April the 15th, but no more. He is worth everything to me. From now on, I will work on making Jesus my everything. I will do it, because by God's grace and his mercy, when Jesus went into heaven, he sent us a friend, a comforter, a helper, a guide, a director, the greatest spiritual director, Holy Spirit. He said, you must have to let me go to his disciples once, when disciples were saying, we are not going to let you go. And Jesus said, I must have to go, because if I don't go, I will not be able to send the helper. Thank God that the burden is not on us. to become good, to earn his salvation, to earn favor in his eyes. He sent us a helper who is willing to help us if we allow him to help us. The problem with us, we are so scared to hear from that helper. We are so scared what Holy Spirit is going to tell us to do, or what Holy Spirit is going to say to give up. Because we don't know the true worth of Jesus. Just like Judas didn't know the true worth of Jesus. He was either a slave for them, less than a slave, or a good teacher, incomplete, nothing. He had no worth and value. My brothers and sisters, Good Friday is not just a tradition that we come in black clothes, shed some tears here, and then after that have a feast at the back. No, it is a day when we reflect upon the death and crucifixion of Jesus Christ, and then we don't see Jesus on the cross, see yourself. Will you be able to bear what he bore on the cross? Can you stand where he was standing? No, we can't. That's why he did. So our response should be, Jesus, you are worth everything to me. If today you will ask me to leave everything, I will leave everything. Because it's Jesus's word. Those who love their mom, dads, pops, uncles and aunts, jobs, family and friends, world, everything all around them, they are not worthy of me. What is most important in your life? Examine. This is the time when I just want all of us to examine our hearts. Then we will continue with this message on Easter Sunday too. These are not some traditions that we follow. This is our faith. This is our, I'm not going to call it religion, but this is where we learn the worth of Jesus. Let's just pray. Reflect in your hearts and ask God to reveal whatever is stopping us in following Christ. Or whatever is becoming most important, more important than Christ. Only he has a power to take that burden away. Let's pray. Father God, Lord Jesus, Holy Spirit, we just come in your presence. Burdened by our sin, our shame, our guilt. You took that pain on the cross. You take it upon yourself. We sing you paid it all. And all to you we owe. But we don't really mean it, Lord. As sitting in this church 2,000 years down the road, Lord God, we reflect upon the marvelous things you have done on the cross. We marvel at it too. But we don't mean it. Father God, so many of us have so many other things that we have before you. It is so easy for us. It is becoming even easier for this generation to give preference to other things than you, Lord God. If there's a choice to pick you and something else, we always pick something else more appealing to our eyes, more pleasurable, more comfortable than you, Lord Jesus. This Good Friday, I pray for this congregation and all those who are in attendance here and all those who decided to stay home for whatever reason. Lord God, I just pray that you touch this congregation. You touch each and every person who is present here. And also those who are in other congregations. Lord God, we see the decline and the rot in the churches, Lord God. I just ask you that you send your Holy Spirit, because you said that in the last days I will pour out my Holy Spirit on the sons and daughters. Lord God, send your Holy Spirit powerfully in this nation, that your Holy Spirit will sweep over this nation, Lord God. that we will get out of the meaningless things that we do, and we will make you the Lord of our lives, the King of all kings, the most important person in our lives, Lord God. I especially pray for me as well, Lord God. Help me. Help me to lead this congregation where you want it to go, Lord God. Guide me. Send your Holy Spirit. Let us not be dead, Lord God, anymore, but let us be fully alive, because your Spirit comes to give us life. Fill each and everyone who is sitting here with your life, Lord. And yes, Lord, we know that this is too much of a heavy burden, but you said, come all those who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Lord Jesus, let us not just keep repeating these words, but let us trust your words, Lord God. Take all the burdens upon you, Lord Jesus. You took it, and you're willing to take it again. We lay down our burdens at the feet of the cross. Father God, help us to become your hands and feet in this community, Lord God. We're back in front, right and left. People are dying without knowing you, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, help us. Show us where to go. Bring those people to us so that we can witness to them. Open our tongues. Loosen it, Lord God, so that we can share them, share your goodness with them, Lord God. And not just share it with our mouth, but live it, Lord God, so when they will see us, they will see you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father God, for sending your Son to die on the cross for me, for my girls, for my family, for this congregation and their families. Thank you for doing that. Thank you for your amazing love that cleansed us from all the sins. No matter whatever we did or whatever we are going to do, you have cleansed us. Your love covered it all. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now give us a heart that can respond positively to your message, Lord God. Help us. In your name I pray. Amen.
Before we sing the last song, Darlene has a small testimony that she would like to share. So Darlene, you want to come forward and share what God has done for you?
A couple of weeks ago, I had asked for prayer for a food bank client. This woman's brother had a girlfriend who was 6.5 months pregnant and ended up going into labor, and the baby was born and they had to be taken to Hamilton, and the mother and the baby both, they didn't know if they were going to make it or not. They thought they might both die. Well, that food bank client contacted me the day before yesterday, and the mother and baby have now been released from the hospital. They're okay.
The Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you, darling. So let's all rise for our recessional song. Will be, Are You Washed in the Blood of the Lamb? So we'll sing together.
Are you washing the blood? washed in the blood of the Lamb. Will your soul be ready for the nations bright and be washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed?
And so for a place to bury the strangers in, they gave the price of their old Messiah who lay in a borrowed grave. This is a little part from William Bland's poem. Let's all say the Lord's Prayer together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forever. May you go and proclaim his gospel to